We bow before thee in this solemn hour of Earth's history, understanding that the work of Christ as our high priest and intercessor is soon to close. None know how soon, but the times are showing that the work of Christ is about to close. The probationary period given to man for the development of character, Lord, is about to end. And in these moments that remain of Earth's history, while war and turmoil, strife and bloodshed, crime and violence are reaching its height, while the mystery of iniquity goes forth to fill up the cup, Lord, we pray and ask, please grant us this evening thy Holy Spirit, that he will abide with us. Give us the early rain, that we might be transformed by the renewing of our minds, and that we might have our vessels empty and purified, that when it's time for to pour out your Spirit, we can receive it. But for now, Lord, we ask thee, please be our divine teacher tonight. No man is sufficient for these things. I'm not sufficient. So, Lord, I ask thee, please, grant us thy Holy Spirit. May the Spirit of God take these lips of clay and use them for your glory. Cleanse me from all unrighteousness. Sanctify me, we pray, by the power of thy Spirit, that it be not me to speak, but that your Spirit and your word speak to thy people. We ask this in Jesus' name, and for his sake, we address our prayer to the most holy place of the heavenly sanctuary. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. I'd like for you to turn to your Bibles with me now to Daniel chapter 11, verse 40. Daniel chapter 11, verse 40. Now, I'm going to start off with a statement, because I found in Adventism today that we have some that believe Uriah Smith's position that the king of the north is Turkey. And some are being very critical about this position to the point that they're saying that if you preach anything else, then you are preaching heresy. But brothers and sisters, I want to read a statement to you to let you know that before Uriah Smith changed his position in 1877, for 16 years prior, Uriah Smith taught, along with James White, that the king of the north of Daniel chapter 11, verse 40, with the time frame at the time of the end, he taught that the king of the north was the papacy. And I'm saying this because we're in a time in Adventism where we're hauling down the issue of the little horn of Daniel chapter 7. We're saying that this little horn is Rome, or we won't say the papal power, as we should say. We're even saying that the little horn of Daniel 7 is, some say it's the church, and they leave it kind of sketchy. But brothers and sisters, God's word is not sketchy. And Seventh-day Adventists are not to guess at anything, but we are to know of a certainty what we believe and why we believe it. And here, I want to share this statement, and you can find this statement in the book Words to the Little Flock, in which it was taught the belief that the king of the north of Daniel 11:45, you remember James White and Ellen White have that pamphlet, Words to the Little Flock. You remember that booklet, right? They put out that book, and in that book it said they taught that which was, they believed, it says, a word to the little flock, in which was taught the belief that the king of the north of Daniel 11:45 is the persecutor of the true church, the beast power of Revelation 13. Now, by the way, who is the beast power, Revelation 13? By the way, Revelation 13, in the beginning. What is a beast in Bible prophecy? A beast represents a nation. Is that right? Daniel 7:23 said, thus he said, the fourth beast shall be the fourth kingdom upon the earth. So the Bible shows a beast is a kingdom or a what? Nation. The first beast comes up out of the what? Sea. What does a sea represent in Revelation 13:1? A sea found in what Bible text tells you about the sea? Revelation 17:15. He said that the waters which thou sawest where the whore sitteth, remember, are people what? Multitudes, nations, and tongues. Is that right? And so the Bible says very clearly that a beast represents a nation, and a nation came up out of the sea. But what did the sea, what was the sea a symbol of historically? It was a symbol of the old world. Is that right? And the old world, this beast power rose up out of the old world, out of the crowded nations of what place? Europe. Are you with me now? And so the Bible shows very clearly here in Revelation 13 that that first beast was the great Antichrist of Bible prophecy, or the Roman papacy. And by the way, we use that term because this was the same term that many of the reformers used when they pointed out the beast power of Revelation 13 and also Revelation 17, the great whore that sits upon many waters. Is that right? Now, this is our position. And so I want you to just think about this. You can go back and read it. It's much more, but I don't have time to go into all of it. In Daniel 11:40, look what the Bible says. Now, I want you to notice the time frame of Daniel 11:40. We're going to look at some biblical principles of how we interpret this, because others are condemning this verse or the interpretation of the papacy because they're saying that everything in Daniel 11 is literal. But when we get to verse 40, we start talking about it's spiritual. Brothers and gentlemen, everything in Daniel 11 is literal. But also there was changes, and with nations conquering each other, that whatever nation occupies a particular territory, that nation became literally that king of the north or the king of the south. Are you with me now? So we're not spiritualizing anything, even though there's a spiritual principle that makes it so as well. We're going to see that as we go. At the time of the end shall the king of the south push at him, and the king of the north shall come against him like a whirlwind, with chariots and with horsemen and with many ships. And he shall eat him to the countries and shall overflow and pass over. Now, first of all, what is our time frame here? The time of the what? End. Now, we're going to look at Bible texts that point out or mention this issue of the time of the end. Because Seventh-day Adventists should not be guessing about the time of the end. The time of the end is not 1844. 1844 starts taking you into the time of the end, but the last days. But your time of the end is marked by a particular event that would take place. And you're going to see it from, we're going to look at it from the Bible. And most of you already know, but I'm just giving you the, just keeping your ears a little open so you can listen for the next few moments. Are you with me now? I don't want you to go to sleep. You got plenty of time to go to sleep. If you drove a long way and you really feel tired and you need to get up and stretch, it's okay. I understand. All right? I won't take offense by it. Are you with me now? All right. The Bible says, now what or when is the time of the end? First of all, let's look at some events or some situations that will take place with God's people that will lead up to the time of the end in Daniel chapter 11, verses 33 to 35. And when you get there, just say amen. Daniel 11, verses 33 to 35. Are you there? The Bible says, and they that understand among the people shall instruct many, yet they shall fall by the sword and by flame, by captivity and by spoil, what everybody? Many days. Now, in your King James Version, I want you to just mark something with me for a minute. It said they shall fall by what? Sword and flame and captivity many days. Okay? Now, let's go left. Let's read the next verse. It says, now when they shall fall, they shall be hoping with a little help, but many shall cleave unto them with flatteries, and some of them of understanding shall fall to try them and to purge and to make them white, even to the what, everybody? Time of the what? End. So just prior to the time of the end, a persecution will come upon God's people that is so bad that many will fall by sword, by flame, and it says to purge and make them what? White. Now, how do you become white? Remember what the Bible says. And now, first of all, in order to be made white, we can only be washed to be made white. If you're with me now, you understand that? The Bible says in Isaiah 1:18 and 19, come now, let us what? Reason together. Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be what? Whiter than snow. And though they be red like crimson, they shall be as what? Wool. Now, the Bible says over in Revelation chapter 1, looking at verses 1 through 5, remember this one? And look at verse 5, mark it when you with me. The revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave unto him, to show unto his servants things which will shortly come to pass. He sent and signified it by his angel unto his servant John, who bear record of the word of God and of the testimony of Jesus Christ and of all things that he what? Saw.
Blessed is he that readeth, and they that hear the words of this prophecy, and keep those things which are written therein, for that time is at hand. John, to the seven churches were in Asia. Grace be unto you and peace from him which is, which was, which is to come, and from the seven spirits which are before his throne. And then it says, and from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the first begotten of the dead, unto him who what? Loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood. He did what? He loved us and washed us from our sins in his what? Own blood. Are you with me now? So the Bible shows that, first of all, we only can be washed or made white by the blood of the Lamb. Are you with me now? And so the Bible says that these who are going to be persecuted are going to be washed in the blood of the Lamb. They're going to be made white by the blood of Jesus and by their faith in him. They are operating on righteousness by faith, meaning that the actual doctrine of righteousness by faith was even taught during the days of persecution, when God's people were being persecuted. As they act out on that faith, they were experiencing his righteousness, even though they would die. But through his righteousness, they would be made what? White, purified, purged, and made white through persecution. Are you with me now? So let's go a little bit closer at this for a moment. The Bible says in 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 12, yea, and all that will live what? You see, a lot of people think, a lot of Christians in the other churches believe they're going to escape persecution. They're going to believe they're going to be raptured up. But the Bible does not give you any type of indication that you're going to escape persecution. Even some Adventists believe somehow they're going to escape persecution. Brothers and sisters, when it really get down to it, you're going to be standing alone somewhere, and you better know Jesus for yourself. You better not only know the song, Abide With Me, but you better be hiding in him. Are you with me now? You better be sure you're on a rock, on a sure foundation, so that when the winds come and the storm comes, you won't be swept away by the current that's going to come, and that will be relentless in fury. A storm is gathering around us today in our churches. A storm is gathering in this country. A storm that's going to come because we want to understand something. When you watch the Jesuit Pope get elected and all the American politicians were all happy and went to greet him, you forgot one thing. America has reached across the Gulf to clasp hands with Rome. As a result, the Protestants are now in a position where Protestantism is about to be dead. And now the final death knell has come to destroy the middle class. What do you mean destroy the middle class? What do you mean? Because the purpose of the Jesuits was the Counter-Reformation. But the purpose of the papacy in general is to undo all that Protestantism has ever done. And now you're watching that event. The undoing of the wealth of Protestantism. That's what you're watching. You can talk about the debt ceiling. You can talk about our losing our world reserve currency. All this has been manipulated and manufactured and engineered by the powers of Rome and the secret societies that are under their dominion. We need to understand, and behind that is the devil and his angels himself. Because he's preparing for the final climax to make war with the remnant of her seed, which keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus, which is the spirit of prophecy. I'm telling you where we're heading at. This is why you better become rooted and grounded in this message. Going on, though, in Daniel 11:35, the Bible tells us this here. Look very carefully how long this period would be. Daniel chapter 11, let's look at verse 35. Are you looking at that picture with me again? Remember that? I gave you that here. I think we read it, didn't we? Daniel 11:35. Are you there? I hear amen. Okay, finally. Okay, thank you. Daniel 11:35, the Bible says, and some of them of understanding shall fall, to try them, but listen carefully, and purge and make them white. Even, now watch this, even to the what? Time of the end, but watch this, because it is yet for what? Appointed time. Now this, the Bible said this time of the end is marked as a what type of time? An appointed time means a time that has a beginning and a time and it has an end to it. Are you with me now? And so, but this is appointed time. But let's see for a moment. In Daniel chapter 12, verse 8, look what the Bible, I'm sorry. Let me look over Daniel 7:25. Let's see if we have a time, an appointed time here mentioned in Daniel chapter 7, verse 25. And when you get there, just say amen. Are you there? In Daniel chapter 7, verse 25, I'll read it so I won't quote the scripture so fast. Sorry about that. Just get used to that when you're an evangelist. Look what the Bible says here in Daniel 7:25. And he shall speak great words against the Most High, and shall wear up the saints of the Most High and think to change what, everybody? Times and laws, and they shall be given into his hands unto a time and what, everybody? A dividing of time. A time is 360. Times 2 is 720. A half a time is 180. 360 plus 720 plus 180 is what? 1,260 years. Remember, even to the time of the end, for it is for an appointed time. But an appointed time is a time that's been designated by God. An appointed time has a beginning and an ending date. But the ending date of this appointed time marks the beginning of the time of the end. Are you with me now? Let's go a little bit closer and you'll see more with me. Let's go look at Daniel chapter 12, verse 7. Let's go there in Daniel 12, verse 7. Looking at this issue again. I'm talking about the event that leads up to the time of the end. The issues that are events that take place. In Daniel chapter 12, verse 7, the Bible says, "And I heard a man clothed in linen, which was upon the waters of the river, when he held up his right hand and his left hand unto the heaven, and swore by him that liveth forever and ever, that there shall be for a time, times and a half. And when he shall have accomplished to scatter the power of the holy people, all these things shall be finished." Now, I need to know something now. If you're a good Bible scholar, the first thing you're going to think about is this. A good Bible student, you don't have to be a scholar to be a student. Listen carefully. The Bible says here, I want to know, who is this man that stands on the near the river and swears by him that liveth forever and ever? Because that looks familiar to me. I believe I read that somewhere in Revelation chapter 10. Do you remember anything like that in Revelation chapter 10? Let's go to Revelation chapter 10. Let's compare. Because Daniel and Revelation should be studied how? Conjointly. You should know that each of these books interlock. Daniel and Revelation are one. Look what the Bible says here in Revelation chapter 10. I want to know who this man is. Because you see, you can't have prophecy without talking about this man. Oh, Lord, if you know who this man was, somebody called him the branch over in Isaiah. Somebody else called him the sweet rose of Sharon. Somebody said he was the I Am. Who is this man that swears by him that liveth forever and ever? Look what the Bible says here in Revelation chapter 10. The Bible says here in Revelation chapter 10, look here in verse 5 and 6. "And the angel which I saw stand upon the sea and upon the earth lifted up his hand," where, everybody? To heaven. Does that sound familiar? Did we read that a minute ago? Look what it says here. "And swore by him that liveth forever and ever, who created heaven and the things that therein are, and the earth and the things that therein are, and the sea and the things that therein are, that there should be time no longer." But notice here, the same connotation is given. But this one who lifts up his hand towards heaven, John says that this is the one that created heaven and the things that therein are, and the earth and the things that therein are, and the sea and the things that therein are. Who is this man? John 1:1 says, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by him, and without him, about this man, was not anything made that was made. He was in the world," in John 1:10, "and the world was made." The word "made" is the equivalent of the Hebrew word "created" by him. Who is this man? "Whether there be thrones, dominions, principalities, or powers, all things were made by him and for him, and by him do all things consist." Who is this man? It's none other than Jesus himself. Jesus, the Bible said, "The Word was made flesh and dwelt among us," in John 1:14 and in John 1:17, "and we beheld his glory, the glory of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. For the law was given by Moses, but grace and truth came by Jesus Christ our Lord." So we find that Jesus is the man in Daniel chapter 11 that swears by him that lived forever and ever. And do you know the Bible says that no, only God can swear, and God can swear by none greater than himself. So we find here that this is what we're looking at. But look at here, so this man is Jesus. How do we know it's Jesus? Remember what the angel was? John said the angel. But who was this angel? This is the mighty angel of Revelation chapter 10 that came down in a cloud, clothed with the sun. Who is this angel that came down with a cloud, clothed with the sun? What is the sun a symbol of? Let's see what the Bible says. I just want to identify this angel because I want you to understand that the same Jesus that starts the Advent movement is the same Jesus that's taking us back in time to show us the early history of Adventism and is going to bring us up to show us the repeating of Adventism's history. The characteristics will come in their order and you're going to see it. But look what the Bible said. I asked, who is this man? Look what the Bible says. He says his face in Revelation chapter 10. Looking here at verse, I believe it's verse 1, isn't it? And I saw another mighty angel come down from where? Heaven, clothed with a what? Cloud. And a rainbow was upon his face. A rainbow was upon his head. And his face was as it were the what? Sun. Now this angel was what? What was his face like? So if I had to get the identity, I need to find out what sun represents. Isn't that right? Look what the Bible says in Revelation chapter 1. And let's look at verses 12 through 16. Revelation chapter 1, verses 12 through 16. Are you there? Revelation chapter 1, verses 12 through 16, the Bible says, and I turned to see the voice that spake with me. And being turned, I saw seven golden candlesticks. And in the midst of the seven candlesticks, one like the Son of Man, clothed with a garment down to his foot, and girded about with paps and a golden girdle. His hair and his head was white like wool, white as snow. And his eyes was a flame of fire. His feet were like fine brass as they burned in a furnace. And his voice is the sound of many waters. And he had in his right hand seven stars. And out of his mouth went a sharp two-edged sword. And his countenance was as the sun shineth in his strength. Whose countenance was as the sun shineth in his strength? Jesus' countenance was as the sun shineth in his strength. So who is this angel? It's none other than Jesus. And what does the sun give, by the way? Come on, I want you to get this. Because remember, you talk about light all the time, but we take it for granted. God says, walk in the light. What light are you talking about? The light of the sun of righteousness. Remember Malachi 4:2, unto you that fear my name, shall the sun of what? Righteousness arise with healing in his wings. But now get this, though. But what is light? Get this. I want you to get this. What is light? You know what light is? Psalms 119:105 says what? Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. So the Bible is what? Light. What is light? John 8:12, Jesus said, I am the light of the world. He that followeth me shall not walk in darkness, but shall have the light of what? Life. But now what is light? The Bible says here in Proverbs 6:23, the commandment is a lamp, the law is a light, and reproof and instruction are the way of life. But now what is light? The Bible says we also have a more sure word of prophecy that we do well to take heed as a lamp, as a light that shineth in a dark place till the day dawn and the day star arise in our hearts. The Bible said Jesus is light. The word is light. The law is light. But then he says prophecy is light. So the Bible makes it clear again. But now let's go back now. So we know now who this angel is in Daniel chapter 12 verse 7. The same angel that's mentioned in Revelation chapter 10. None other than Jesus himself. Look here, the Bible says in Daniel chapter 12, verse 8, and I heard, but understood not. Then I said, oh, my Lord, when shall the end of these things be? I'm talking about the time of the end still. I want you to see things that lead up to that event. Listen very carefully. The Bible says here in Daniel 12, 9, it says, and he said, go thy way, Daniel, for the words are what? Words are sealed up when? Until it says sealed up till the time of the what? End. Here's that issue of time of the end again. Does the book of Revelation, now we saw Daniel mention it, does the book of Revelation now talk about that same period? We're going to look a little closer and we're going to see. But I want to show you something. In the book of Revelation, Revelation chapter 12 is divided into three parts. You have the church, you have the apostolic history of the church, you have the church in the wilderness, and you have the remnant church phase. Daniel chapter 12 that we just read about, and the persecution that took place in Daniel 11, verses 34 to 33 to 35, is all talking about the same event that's mentioned in Revelation 12, 14, which is dealing with the church in the wilderness. The what, everybody? The church in the wilderness. Look what the Bible says in Revelation 12, 14. And the woman, it says here, and to the woman was given two wings of a great eagle, that she might fly into where, everybody? Into the wilderness, it says here, into her place where she is nourished for a what? Times, here it is again, times and what? And a half a time from the face of the serpent. And notice very carefully, what is it again? Times, times, and a half a times. How many times have you heard this so far? Three times. Let's see how many times God mentioned it, because it means if God is mentioning something more than that, it means it's so important that you cannot skip over it or howl down or play it off as though it's non-essential or not important to prophecy and for the people of God as a foundation and a landmark. Are you understanding me now? Listen a little closer with me now. Look at Revelation 12:6. Look at Revelation 12:6. And the woman fled where? Into the where? Into the wilderness, where she is placed. She has a place prepared that it says of God that she should be fed there for what? 1,260 what? Days. Now notice very carefully. What is a day in Bible prophecy? How do you know? What Bible text you got? I'm from Missouri. Show me. Ezekiel 4:6. Turn me to Ezekiel 4:6. The Bible says, and when thou hast accomplished them, lie again on thy right side, and thou shalt bear the iniquity of the house of Judah 40 days. I have appointed what? Each day for a what? Year. Each day for what? Year. Now that was, but in the mouth of two witnesses, a thing must be established. Turn me to Numbers 14:34. Numbers 14:34. Are you there? Okay, I only got one person said yes. Are you there now? Don't go to sleep on me now. I'm trying to keep you woke. Amen, somebody. Look what the Bible says. And after the number of days in which he searched the land, even 40 days, each day for a what? A year shall ye bear the iniquity, even 40 years, and ye shall know my breach of promise. And so we find that a day in Bible prophecy stands for a year. We already know that that's what the Bible says, and we know the time period. Now let's think about this time period. We know it's 1,260 years. During this period, the saints of God were to be persecuted. They would be put to the flame, burned at the stake, if you please. They were to be purged and tried, made white through the blood and through the righteousness of Christ. Genesis 41:32. Listen carefully. Why does God repeat things? I want to make sure you understand. Why does God repeat things? You know, parents says, you know, some parents get tired of repeating, but God never gets tired of repeating. He has a point every time. In Genesis 41:32, listen what Joseph told Pharaoh. It says, and for that the dream was doubled unto Pharaoh twice. It is because the thing is established by God, and he will shortly bring it to pass. Or God will shortly bring it to pass. Why does God repeat things? Because the thing is what? Established, and God will shortly bring it to pass. Let's go one more step. Deuteronomy 19:15. Turn with me there. Deuteronomy 19:15. Talking about Daniel 11:40. I'm going to you step by step. And I want you to have no mistake about the time of the end. We are in the very ends of time, and we need to know this history if we will understand what the future is about to hold. We have no fear for the future. Except what, everybody? As we forget how God has led us in his past what? Teachings and history. Do you know your teachings? Do you know your history? If you don't, then you have a fear for the future. Let's go closer. The Bible says in Deuteronomy 19:15, one witness shall not rise up against a man for any iniquity or for any sin. It says here that he sinneth at the mouth of what? Two witnesses, or at the mouth of what? Three witnesses, shall a matter be established. Wish people believed that today. You cut down on a lot of gossip and misunderstandings. In Revelation 13:5, turn with me there. Let's see this time period again. The Bible says here, and there was given unto him a mouth speaking great things and blasphemies, and power was given unto him to continue what? 42 months. 42 months, 30 days in a month, 30 times 42 is what? 1,260. All right? And Revelation 11:3, let's look at it one more time. And I will give power to my two witnesses, and they shall prophesy 1,260 days, clothed with sackcloth. How long will he prophesy? 1,260 days. How many times has God mentioned his prophecy? 7 times. And if he mentioned it twice, that means the thing is going to be what? Established. If he mentioned it 7 times, then what does that mean? It means it's of vital importance, and that you are not to forget the history concerning this power. And this power ruled from 538 AD to 1798. Remember, they were to rule to the time of the end because it was for an appointed time. The beginning period started in 538 for the 1260, and it ended in 1798. 1798 marks the time of the end. Okay? Everybody with? Marks the time of the end. Now, to get people not get confused on Daniel 11, remember verse 36 of Daniel chapter 11. Listen what it says. It says, and he, now to show you that verse 36 is dealing with the papacy and not Turkey, notice what the Bible says. It says, in fact, before we get there, I forgot one thing. No, okay. It says, watch very carefully. It says here in Daniel 11, 36, says, and he, contextually, he is talking about the king of the north, which in this case is the papacy. He, the papacy, shall prosper till what? Till the indignation be accomplished. Now, what is indignation? Until wrath, anger, fury, rage is accomplished. In other words, until he continues his, until the persecution period or the duration of time that God has allotted for the persecution of his people be accomplished. Is that clear to everybody? Before I go to the next point now, are we clear about the time and the end? From 538 to what? March 1798 marks the time of the what? Time of the end. 538 marks the union of church and state when the papacy in the 6th century became fully established and the Pope began to reign over the churches of Christendom. Are you understanding me now? All right, I want to make it very plain. All right? Now, let's go a little bit closer now. Let's examine. Now, look at Daniel 11:40. Daniel 11:40 says, at the time of the end, shall the king of the south do what? Push at him. Now, by the way, now, so the king of the north, we're going to find is the papacy. We're going to go into more detail about it a little bit later. But I want to just give you this a little bit more so you can get this. So the Bible says that at the time of the end, the king of the south is going to push at him. Now, we need to figure out who the king of the south is. Now, I'm going to introduce to you a principle that the Bible teaches about how you take things that are literal. What dispensation can you take things that are literal and see that they also are spiritual? I want you to see this with me. First of all, look at 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 46. In 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 46, the Bible says, howbeit that was not first, which is what? Spiritual. But that which is what? Natural. Natural would also mean literal as well, or in existence. Are you with me now that you can even see? It says, afterwards, that which is what? Spiritual. So in order for me to know something that's going to be what? Spiritual, I must also first understand the natural or literal aspect of that power and how it affects God's people or his church. Are you understanding me now? It's very important that you know this principle. So Paul says that the natural or literal came first before the what? Spiritual. All right? So if I'm looking at Daniel 11, and I want to know who was the natural king of the north and the south, but if I go a little bit further, I would ask you, who was the actual kings of the north, south, east, and west before the rise of pagan Rome? And you have to go back to Daniel 7 and look at the four-headed leopard that came up, which represented Grecia, and these were the four generals that came up after the death of Alexander the Great. Remember, Daniel 11 opens up dealing with Medo-Persia, then it goes to a long list of the Grecian kings, and then it takes you into pagan Rome, then it makes a transition by verse 30, 31, about papal Rome, and it takes you all the way down to the time of the end when the papacy will receive a deadly wound. I'm just giving you the outline of the chapter so you can get a picture. And so we're going to find in that the kings of the north and south were developed in the Grecian kingdom of Alexander's four generals. Remember, his generals was Cassander, Ptolemy, Seleucus, and who else? Cassander, Ptolemy, Seleucus, and Lysimachus. And remember something about these four generals. They conquered and warred against each other until you went from the east and the west ceased. The kings that ruled, those Grecian kings that ruled the east and west, they ceased, and only two Grecian kings were left, the Ptolemies in the south
and the Seleucids in the north. These were the literal kings of the north and south in the time when Grecia was still ruling the world and Rome was about to come on the scene and establish division with Romulus and Remus, beginning that period of that history. You can go back and read it. Later, the king of the north, which was under Seleucids, he decided that he was going to attack the king of the south. And I'm just making it very plain, very quickly. And you go back and read the history, but the king of the north later decided he was going to attack the king of the south. But the king of the south, and the reason why he wanted to do it, because the king of the south had a child king on the throne. And the southern kingdom decided that they would have to fight. They needed some help. So they heard about a band of people that they called the robbers of the people, or they called the Romans. And they asked the Romans to help them. The Romans agreed on one condition, that the child king would become tribute to Rome if they should conquer the king of the north. I'm talking about the literal aspect of historical documentation dealing with the king of the north and king of the south. And so they agreed, and the king of the north attacked the king of the south, but the king of the south was defended by the Romans, who actually came out, rose up on the outside of the Macedonian Empire. But at the same time, they conquered the king of the north. Whatever power conquers a particular geographical location, that power becomes the king of the north or the king of the south. In this case, when Rome conquered the northern kingdom of the Seleucids, the Romans began to establish division, and they became the kings of the north, the king of the north, and they also had the child king of the south as tribute. So they were rising to become the sole rulers of the then known world. Now that's literal. First the what? Natural, then the what? Spiritual. But pagan Rome had a worship. What was the worship of pagan Rome? They worshiped the who? The sun god, Mithra. Is that right? And then, we're going to find that one of the characteristics, also Romans also believed in immortality of the what? Soul. So you're going to find that these were also characteristics of the pagan culture of the Roman Empire. And later, we're going to find that when Rome would begin to deteriorate in the West, and because Constantine would take the capital of Rome and move it to the where? Eastern part of the empire, which was Constantinople. Are you with me now? When he did that, he left the West open to the barbarians. Are you with me now? And the barbarians attacked, and on the ruins of the barbarian hordes of the Western Roman Empire, on the ruins of what was left of Rome, rose the papacy. And she became enthroned and took the place of the Caesars. And when she became enthroned and took the place of the Caesars and became fully established in 538, what did that indicate? Who then now is the literal as well as the spiritual king of the north? The papacy. So we got the literal, the natural aspect in the transition of history, and we also have the spiritual aspect staring us right there in the face as well. And so it's unmistakable that the king of the north of Daniel 11:40 is none other than the papacy. Are you with me now? Is that clear? Is that hard? Was that hard? No, okay, let's go a little closer now. So now what the Bible says, and at the time of the end, the king of the south shall push at him. But now who is this south? The Bible gives a description about the south. Look at here, first of all, the south. Okay, if you look up the word south right there in your actual Strong's Concordance, the word south represents, it says, Egypt. Okay? But now, what is it about Egypt that's so important that God would bring up this power? Let's see something. First of all, where is the south located in the scripture? Let's take a look at this for a moment. The Bible says in Genesis chapter 12, verse 7 through 10. Let's see, well, for a minute, about the south. Genesis chapter 12, verses 7 through 10. And it says, and the Lord appeared to Abram and said unto him, said unto thy seed will I give this land. And there built he an altar unto the Lord who appeared unto him. And he removed from thence unto the mountain on the east of Bethel and pitched his tent, having Bethel on the west and Ai on the east. And there he built an altar unto the Lord and called upon the name of the Lord. And Abraham took journey. And Abraham journeyed going towards the where? South. And now listen where the south was at. And there was a famine in the land. And Abraham went down into where, everybody? Egypt to sojourn, for there the famine was grievous in the land. Egypt is connected to the what? South. Let's go a little closer. Let's get Isaiah chapter 30, verse 1 with me. Isaiah chapter 30, verse 1. I'm talking about proving from the scriptures your position on Daniel 11, 40. Look what the Bible says in Isaiah 30, verse 1. Woe to the rebellious children, saith the Lord, that counsel, but not of me. Watch this. It says, woe to the rebellious children, saith the Lord, that take counsel, but not of me, and that cover with a covering, but not of my spirit, that they may add sin to what? Sin, that walk and go down into where? Egypt, and have not asked at my mouth to strengthen themselves in the strength of Pharaoh, and to trust in the shadow of who? Of Egypt. Now, notice again, who's in the south? Egypt. Let's look again. Isaiah 30, verse 6 and 7. Look what the word of God says again. Isaiah chapter 30, verses 6 and 7 now. The burden of the beast of the what? Of the south. What's a beast in scripture? A nation. So let's break it down. The burden of the nation of the south. Let's see who that nation of the south is. It says, in the land of trouble and anguish, whence came the young and the old lion, the viper and the fiery flying serpent. They will carry their riches upon their shoulders of young asses, and their treasures upon the bunches of camels, to the people that shall not profit them, and the Egyptians shall help in vain, and to no purpose. Therefore have I cried concerning this strength is to sit still. Now, who's the burden of the south, beast of the south? For the Egyptians shall help where? In vain. So we're going to see it. We see it again. But notice very carefully here. Now, so we're going to find that the king of the south is represented by Egypt. But now, do we have anything else that's connected to this? Turn me to Revelation chapter 11, verse 3. I want you to notice very carefully. Revelation 11, verse 3. God's word was to prophesy for 1,260 years. But near the end, just prior to the end of this 1,260 years, God's word, or his people also, who would stand for right and be purged and purified, would meet with a new power that would rise up a beast from the bottomless pit. And this power would come right near the end when the 1,260 years were about to expire. In Revelation 11, 3, it says, and I will give power to my what? Two witnesses. Now, these two witnesses represent the Old and New Testament. All right? Are you with me now? Now, what's the purpose of a witness, by the way? Turn to Proverbs 14, 5. Proverbs 14, 5. I want you to know the purpose of a witness right quick. Even the two witnesses of the Old and New Testament. Are you with me? Are you there? Proverbs 14, 5. Not there yet. Only when you say amen. Well, I know. Otherwise, we'll be here. Now, don't say I'm just preaching long. I'm going to just say I was waiting on you. Are you there? Look what the Bible says. It says in Proverbs 14, 5, a faithful witness will not what? Lie. Does God's words lie? Titus 1, 2 says, in hope of eternal life, whom God who cannot lie promised before the world began. And Psalms 119, 160 says, thy word is true from the beginning. So God's word is a what? Faithful what? Faithful witness, it says here, but a false witness will utter lies. Look at verse 25. Verse 25 of the same chapter. A true witness delivereth what? Souls. But a deceitful witness speaketh what? Lies. So God's word cannot lie, and God's word is a true witness, and the purpose of God's word is to help deliver your soul from sin, and then also deliver you from the thraldom of the devil's temptations, and then in transform your character that you can be prepared to meet the true faithful witness that died to save you on the cross of Calvary. Now look what the Bible goes on and says. Going on, it says here, I will give power to my two witnesses, and they shall prophesy 1,203 score what? Days in sackcloth. Are you with me now? And verse 7 says here, and when they have finished their testimony, Revelation 11, 7, the beast that ascendeth out of the what? Bottomless pit shall make war against them, and shall overcome them, and shall what? Kill them. Now, wait a minute. What's going to come? Who's going to come up? A beast from the bottomless pit. So far, we found out the king of the south represented who? Egypt. Now, the Bible foretells a power called a beast that comes up out of the bottomless pit. This beast from the bottomless pit will have the characteristics of the king of the south. or the characteristics of Egypt. Are you with me now? But what's a beast in the Bible? A nation. So this beast is going to be, or this power is going to be symbolized in a nation that's going to imbibe a philosophy that is contrary to the word of God, but is similar to that of the Pharaoh of Egypt. Are you with me now? Okay, let's take a look at it together. The Bible says here, looking here, so what type of what type of Egypt are we talking about in Daniel chapter 11? Are we talking about, let's look at literal, first the what? Natural, then the what? Spiritual. So let's see, what happened in Egypt that was so marked that God would use Egypt naturally, and what happened to her in the past would be also a symbol of a spiritual power in the last days, the time of the end. Are you with me now? Let's see. Turn me in your Bibles to Exodus chapter 5, verses 1 and 2. Let's take a look. Let's look at literal Egypt and let's see what happened. Are you with me now? Listen carefully. And afterwards, Moses and Aaron went in and told Pharaoh, thus said the Lord God of Israel, let my people, what everybody? Go. And they said that they may hold a feast unto me in the wilderness. And Pharaoh said, who is the Lord that I should obey his voice to let Israel go? I know not the Lord, neither will I let Israel go. Wait a minute. What did Pharaoh say? I know not the Lord, neither will I let Israel go. What is this? This is the introduction of the origin of the beast from the bottomless pit. The philosophy of this beast is the denouncing of the living God that made heaven and earth, the sea and the fountains of waters. It is the introduction or the origin of atheism, if you please. And what does the Bible say about those who say, I don't believe in God? In Psalms 14:1, the Bible says, a fool has said in his heart, there is no God. What did God call you? I remember one day knocking on a door, and a man said to me, hey, man, look at me. Look at me, brother. And I was looking at him, and he said to me, I looked at him, he looked at me. Then he says, read my lips. I don't believe in God. He said, so what you got to say? I said, really, I don't have nothing to say, but I want you to read something for me. And I flipped my Bible around like this and said, can you read this right here for me? I said, you do know how to read, don't you? And he said, oh, I know how to read. What are you talking about? And he picked up, he looked in and he says, a fool has said in his heart, there is no God. He said, hey, man, you called me a fool? I said, no, the Bible did. And he sat there and said, man, come on in my house. Come on in my house. Nobody ever called me a fool like that. But the Bible knows what to do. Sometimes you just got to be tactful at the door. And Patriarchs and Prophets, page 333, listen to what Ellen White says about Pharaoh's position. It says when Moses came in before the king with the message from Jehovah, the God of Israel, it was not ignorance on the part of Pharaoh. He was not ignorant about the true, he was not ignorant concerning the true God, but it was defiance of his power that prompted the answer, who is Jehovah that I should obey his voice? Is that what's happening today? A lot of people are claiming to be atheists, and it's really not ignorance, but it's a defiance of God's power and his right as creator. That's what's happening with a lot of secular humanists as well. Look what the Bible goes on. It's, look at here now. If you don't believe that, we're talking about this power would have two characteristics. In Revelation chapter 11, it said two things. It said something about this power. It said this power would have also two things. It says in Revelation 11:8, it says, and their dead bodies shall lie in the streets, it says, of the great city, which is spiritually called Sodom and Egypt. Now, before I go any further, there are two things you need to identify here in verse 8. You need to know three things. You need to know who is the great city. Because the Bible said that this power would arise from among the great city. Who's the great city in Revelation chapter 11, verse 8. Turn in your Bibles to Revelation 18. Revelation chapter 18. You get there, say amen. Are you okay? Are you there? Revelation 18. Look here for a moment. And I want you to just notice very carefully. Okay? Now, I'm going to take you to verse 17 first, chapter 17, verse 5 a minute. I want you to look at the word great with me for a moment. And upon her forehead was a name written what? Verse 5, Revelation 17, 5, and then I'm coming back to 18. Revelation 17, 5, upon her forehead was a name written what? Mystery, Babylon, the what? The great. Stop. Now, who's called great so far? Babylon. Mystery Babylon. Let's go a little closer now. Turn to chapter 18 with me. Ready? Let's look at verse 9 and 10. And the kings of the earth who have committed fornication with her shall bewail her and lament her, and they shall stand and see the smoke of her burning, standing afar off for the fear at last, as if for the fear of her torment, saying, at last, that what, everybody? That great city, who? Babylon, that mighty city, for in 1 hour is thy judgments come. Who's the great city? Babylon. What Babylon? Mystery Babylon, the great. And so who ruled the world during the time, at the time of this issue of this beast that would come out the bottomless pit? It was the great city, Mystery Babylon, who is called the papacy. How long did the papacy rule? From 538 to 1798. She ruled as the despotism of Europe. Are you with me now? And as a result, near the end, there was a rebellion because, remember, the French Revolution came about and they threw off all restraint concerning religion. And philosophies were being born just prior to that. One was by Thomas Paine, which he wrote the book Age of what? Reason. And therefore, reason would be exalted and become the goddess of reason later, wouldn't it? And then you had a man named who? Voltaire, as well, who said the Bible was a dead book, and in 50 years, the Bible would not be read again. Voltaire is dead, and the Bible is still being read by millions today. Are you understanding me now? And so the Bible shows that this power would be atheist in nature, but then it says something else. It would be like what? Sodom and Gomorrah. But I want you to see Romans chapter 1 with me for just a moment. I wanted to show you. The Bible didn't say they were ignorant of God. Listen to what the Bible said they did. In Romans chapter 1, verse 22. Professing them, it says here, verse 21. Because that when they what? Look at verse 21. Just notice one, just one verse 1. Look what it says, verse 21. Romans 1:21. Because that when they what, everybody? When they knew God, they what? They glorified him not as God, but neither were they thankful, but became vain in their imaginations, and it says, and their foolish hearts were what? Darkened. What does it mean for your heart to be darkened? What's your heart talking about? Your mind, your intellect, their understanding became what? Darkened. When did it become darkened? When they what? Knew God and what? And it says, and glorified him not as God. Neither were thankful. This is what's happening with many of our children. You better pray for your children. Because many of our children have grew up in this message. They know everything. And yet they knew God. But they glorify him not as God. And they become vain in their imaginations through false education. And the false education that we have done to our children is criminal. Because now we got children that got careers. We got children that make money. We got children that got houses and lands, but they have no desire to do the will of God. What did you raise? Careers, working young people who got good jobs and looking good for society, but don't have a desire or a burden for souls or service in the cause of God, and yet you want them to go to heaven? This is a tragedy among us. That we can sit here today and sit there and wonder why we don't have more missionaries in our church. Most of our young people are in the world making money. They don't even believe that the crisis that's taking place right now is of any importance. They believe this too shall pass. Because they've been blinded by the materialism of this world and by the glory of man. And they know about God. They knew about him from growing up. You pay for their college education. You put them in church school, and now they're out there in the world, and then they don't want to, they don't have no desire to come back until, like the prodigal son, they get down to nothing. until they're eating husks like pigs in a pen, until they come down to pauperism and they can't have the material things they want anymore, and they can't play with their gadgets, and they can't play with their cell phones, and they can't get on the internet and everything else, until God brings them to such a degree, until they're so poverty stricken and so financially at a loss that they got to make a decision between the mark of the beast and the Sabbath. Because we won't do what we're supposed to do. And we want to know why our children. The Lord won't save your children, but some are going to go through some hard times. And they're going to have to go through it only so they can get to know God. What you fail to do now in a time of peace, you will do in a time of adversity. You fail to seek the Lord now, you will seek him in a foxhole in the desert storm somewhere when you're fighting for a global government. That's when you will start seeking the Lord. When missiles are over your head and you see your best friend body blown apart, then you'll get on your knees. Then you'll pray. Then you'll say, oh God, where am I? My mother taught me better than this. I ain't had no business holding a machine gun in my hand. I don't have a business throwing a grenade over here blowing people away. I knew better. That's what they're going to say. Weeping, wailing, gnashing of teeth is going to come from many of God's young people. To bring them to their senses. Only through the mercy of God will some get out alive without a scratch, while others will come home with one part missing. Because we train career people. We didn't want missionaries. See, if you're a missionary, you're going to be poor. And I don't want my child to be poor. Now they're poor. Now they're rich with everything else, and they're poor in spirit. Poor in spiritual things, poor in the Bible, poor in understanding the end time events, poor in understanding prophecy, poor in presenting their household and training their children in the way they should go. We better weep between the porch and the altar. We better agonize with God while we can. And some parents have already seen where they made the mistakes, and God is hearing your prayer. Your children are only alive today because of your prayers. Don't you stop praying. Don't stop praying for them. I don't care how hard-headed they are. I don't care how wicked they look. I don't care how much drinking he's doing. I don't care how much drugs he's on. Don't stop praying for your children. Pray that God will bring them back from the dead. Bring them into the land of the living, and they be transformed and be part of the loud cry message. God's going to raise up men in the last days. They won't be qualified by literacy and learning. While our church is putting the clamps down and saying everybody got to have a degree from Andrews and have their doctorate and everything before they get in the pulpit, God's getting ready to change that thing. Oh yeah, a new day is coming in Adventism. This message is not going to die out. We're not going to just go out with a whimper. We're going out in a bang. With a loud voice and with a loud cry, come out of her, my people, that she be not partake of her sins and receive not of her plagues. For her sins have reached unto heaven, and God has remembered her iniquities. We're going to give the second angel's message with a loud cry. I want to be part of it. I don't know about you. Nothing down here I want. I don't know about you. What is you want down here? How much you got? Tomorrow morning we can wake up and have an economic crash. Everything you got in the bank is gone. What you going to do, commit suicide? Huh? Jump in front of a train? Drive away and don't come back? Tell your husband bye-bye since you're poor now. You was with him when he was rich. You was with him when he had cattle and land. Now you're poor. It's Joe's turkey. Don't have a dime to your name. What are you going to do? You're going to panic? Start having heart attacks and high blood pressure? Where are you going to get on your knees? And say, the Lord giveth, and the devil took it away. But blessed be the name of the Lord, for he shall give it back. I don't get it now, I'll get it in glory. I want you to think about it. Get down to the close of this. Now look here for a moment. So we find here in Revelation. What text is that, everybody? All right. In Great Controversy, page 269, talking about this power from the bottomless pit, talking about this power that's like Sodom and Gomorrah, talking about atheism. This is what it says. I know not Jehovah, moreover why I will not let Israel go. Ellen White writes, under the inspiration of the Holy Ghost. Under who, everybody? Inspiration of the Holy Ghost. This is atheism, and the nation represented by Egypt will give voice to similar denial of the claims of the living God. And would manifest a spirit of unbelief and defiance. The great city is also compared spiritually to Sodom. The corruption of Sodom in breaking the law of God was especially manifest in licentiousness. Now, why is that important? Because what you're watching now, you're looking at atheism, secular humanism, is taking over our country. And at the same time, while that's taking over for a while, you also see same-sex marriages come out the closet. And this is especially represented in the breaking of God's law by licentiousness. You saw Supreme Court justices gave the okay to same-sex marriages, even though one Supreme Court justice says to pass this is an act against nature. Ladies and gentlemen, if we will pass a law and make it legal for sodomizing to go on among young people and then say it's okay, and we're going to educate our youth to tell them it's okay to sodomize each other. What type of age are you living in? Have you even understood that from a clinical standpoint, the different diseases that come through sodomy? Because I'm not talking about the person's personality. I'm not talking about the person's attitude. I'm dealing with the very act that is a criminal crime against nature. And if we will do that now in the green tree, in the dry, what are we going to do in the green tree? What are we going to do pretty soon? If we will pass a law and American people go along with this, then you don't have to worry about Sunday. Sunday will pass with flying colors. What type of time are we living in? My. God have mercy on our souls. And then we sit here in the church and want to parlay with it and say, well, you know, we need to embrace them. Every preacher that said that didn't have his credentials taken from him. Sitting here embracing an abomination that the God's called, that's what God called it. Pretty soon you won't be able to preach about it. Might as well go on and say it now. The great city is also compared spiritually to Sodom. The corruptions of Sodom in breaking the law of God was especially manifest in licentiousness. It says, and this sin was also to be preeminent characteristic of the nation that fulfilled the specifications of the scriptures. According to the words of the prophet then, a little before 1798, some power of satanic origin and character would arise to make war on the Bible. Wait a minute. What did the Bible say? Who made the real? Now, the papacy persecuted God's people. The papacy hated the Bible, too. And they know that as long as God's people read the Bible, the papacy can have no real power over Protestants. But that's why we came out with all these other versions, too. So all these different versions of the Bible, so you can have different ones. And you say, well, this one's easier to read, but only one of them got the blood on it. This one got the blood on it. This is the one that was made with blood, sweat, and tears. All right? Your new version is nothing but a corrupt manuscript version from the Vaticanus and Sinaitic texts. You can go back and read it for yourself. You got translation of the history of the translation of the Bible. But go get it by call Orion Publishing or Heartland Publications and get the book. It's there. This book got the blood on it. The Jesuits want to destroy this Bible. For 300 years, they sought to destroy the King James Version of the Bible. And now they finally succeeded by Adventists walking around here on Sabbath school lessons with NIV publications, NIV quotations in the Sabbath school lesson. You cannot prove your position from an NIV. You cannot prove your doctrinal positions from NIV or Clear Word or SN or SUV or whatever you got. You can only prove it from a KJV. And you can't hardly do it from also the new KJV either. We don't want to hear that. Oh, brother, this brother being fanatical. See, you need to have a wide mind. You need to be able to read from a variety. I understand that variety, but when it gets down to the doctrine, when it gets down to knowing what is right, when it gets down to really proving why I'm a Seventh-day Adventist, why I believe in 2300 days, why I know the papacy is the mark of the beast, why I know the second advent will take place, how I know when the hour of God's judgment, you can't do it from any Bible. You've got to use a King James Version, and you've got to know your Bible like the back of your hand. And you better know your history to go with it. Now I'm just making it plain. You can still read all the other versions you want if you want to get a little more insight and a little more understanding, but you better get on your knees and pray and believe that promise found in John 14:26. But the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name, he shall teach you all things and bring all things to your remembrance whatsoever I said unto you. He will what? Teach you all things and bring all things to your remembrance. I got a bad memory. You better call for some divine help then. That's what the word of God said. Just telling you what it is now. So the prophecy had this prophecy received the exact fulfillment, and it says here in the history of the French, or the French Revolution in France. And by the way, was France one of the papal powers? Was France under control of the papacy? The papacy is known as the great city in Revelation 18. And out of that city, one of those nations rose up, and it was France. And it was there in the French Revolution of the Napoleonic Wars. Remember, Napoleon didn't have a stomach problem. He was doing his stance because he is exactly what? Freemason. So the free secret societies of the Freemasons, that was in what year, by the way? 1798. 1776, the Illuminati was born by Adam Weishaupt, an ex-Jesuit. But really not ex, because he really never denounced the order. He just went underground, because in 1773, 3 years before that, the Pope had exiled the Jesuits from and tried to suppress the order. So you need to understand. And so by 1798, the papacy receives a deadly wound. But the French Revolution is caused by Napoleon. But Napoleon is controlled by the secret societies of the Freemasons. And the Freemasons are controlled by the Illuminati, which is the Jesuit order of Adam Weishaupt. And the Illuminati has all their heads and everything. Like an octopus with many arms with one head. Are you understanding me now? If you don't believe that, so now watch this. So communism is born. What's born, everybody? Communism. Karl Marx, 1848, writes the Communist Manifesto. Marx writes what? But where's the Communist Manifesto come from? It comes from the French Revolution, right? But the French Revolution was caused by a group that they had a name called the Jacobites. Remember them? And the Jacobites were actually the Jesuits working through this Jacobite organization to bring about and create the French Revolution. What are we watching in America? Obama's a Muslim, right? No, that's your gossip talk. Obama is an American. His real issue is that his daddy was communist, and it wasn't the one from Africa. And I'm gonna leave it like that. But the issue is socialism is being propagated in America today as we speak. You don't have a republic. You're having a socialist fascist state. And so the same teachings that involved the French Revolution are the teachings that are taking place right now in this country, along with the promotion of Sodom and Gomorrah. Daniel 11, mercy, mercy. So in 1798, atheistic France pushed and waged war against him. Pushing did what, everybody? Waged war on the papacy. And the papacy received a deadly wound. How do we know he got a deadly wound? Revelation 13, 3, what the Bible says? Revelation 13, 3, let's go there. Revelation chapter 13, verse 3. What's the Bible say? And I saw one of his heads, it was what? Wounded to death, and his deadly wound was healed, and all the world did what? Wondered after the beast. Papacy received a deadly wound in 1798. He that lead into captivity shall what? Go into captivity. He that killeth with the sword shall be what? Killed with the sword. How was the papacy wounded? The Bible says he's wounded with a what? Sword. What is the sword that wounded the papacy? Bible text, you're right. Said it right. Turn me to Romans 13. Romans 13, I want you to watch this. Romans 13, I want you to see what wounded the papacy. He that leadeth in captivity shall go into captivity. He that killeth with the sword shall be what? Killed with the sword. What did the papacy kill with? The sword. And what would the papacy be wounded with? The sword. What is the sword that the papacy used to kill with? Look what the Bible says. Let every soul be subject unto the higher powers. For there is no power but of God. And the powers that are, it says here, the powers that be are ordained of who? God. Whosoever therefore resisteth this, the power, resisteth the ordinance of God. And they that resist shall receive to themselves damnation. For the rulers are not a terror to what? Now, I want to stop right here for a minute. What did the Bible say? The rulers are not a what? That's when the rulers are ruling righteously or in right. But let's reverse that. If they're not going to rule right or righteously after a while, what type of, what are they? You got it in your Bible. It says, but to evil, will thou then not be afraid of the power? Do that which is good, and thou shalt have praise of the same. For the minister of God, it says, for he is a minister of God. Now, contextually, who is a minister of God? The rulers of the governments. Are you with me now? They are ministers of God to thee for good. But if thou do that which is evil, be afraid. For he beareth not the what? The sword in vain. For he is a minister of God and a revenger to execute wrath upon him that doeth evil. He that leadeth in captivity shall what? Go into captivity. So how did the papacy get put in captivity? By the same governing power, the same type of government power that she used to persecute God's people, now was brought against her. Are you with me now? That's what you got. Napoleon, was he political or was he religious? He was political. And the French Revolution denounced all what? Religion. So therefore, this political power became the sword that was used by God as a revenger on his two witnesses and put the papacy in captivity and gave her a deadly wound. Okay, I want you to see. And so the Bible says in Daniel 11:36, and the king shall do according. Now, by the way, remember, I just want to make sure you got that. And so we find again here that we find it in Daniel 11:36. Again, it says here, and the king shall do according to his will and shall exalt himself and magnify himself above every god and shall speak marvelous things against the God of gods and shall prosper till the indignation be accomplished. When's the indignation ended? In 17 what? 1798. Revelation 13:3, we know the papacy received the what? Deadly wound. In Revelation 13:10, he that leadeth in captivity shall go into captivity. He that killeth with the sword shall be killed with the sword. So in Daniel 11:40, the Bible said the king of the north shall what? Now that was Daniel 11:40, verse 1. I want to stop there for a minute and give you something to think about. We close out. Daniel 11:40, verse 1. Ellen White would write a statement in Testimonies to the Church. And I want you to listen to the statement carefully because I want you to see something. Yes, I want to point out something that we all need to pay attention to. And it was this. I want to give you some history to go with this later. I want you to see this as we're going to close out with these thoughts. That was Daniel 11:40, verse 1, but with part 1, I said part 1, actually. Not verse 1, but it's Daniel 11:40, part 1. Now, papacy received the deadly wound in 1790 what? 8. Now, Mrs. White says here in Testimonies, Volume 9, she said, the prophecy of the 11th chapter of Daniel has nearly reached complete fulfillment. Soon the scenes of trouble spoken of in the prophecies will take place. Let me read it again. The world is stirred with the spirit of war. The prophecies of the 11th chapter of Daniel has nearly reached its complete fulfillment. Soon the scenes of trouble spoken of in the prophecies will take place. Now, question. That was Testimonies, Volume 9, right? Ellen White said at that time. Now, when was Testimonies, Volume 9 written? It spanned 5 years, but it covers the 55, not the 9 volumes themselves, but especially going up to Volume 9, covers 55 years of the first 55 years of the Advent Church, Advent movement. Testimonies, Volume 9, covers from 1904 to 1909. So we can safely say that in 1909, the closing statement on Daniel 11 was that it almost meant fulfillment in her day. Now, in her day, the king of the north had received the what? By the time she's writing this, the king of the north is still wounded. Is that right? And she was wounded by who? Atheism. Is that right? Napoleon, okay? Man, I wish the screen was working, but man, we got next time I'll just put it on the wall, okay? I read at this point. But anyway, I'll try to reiterate it maybe tomorrow afternoon on the last one. But I'm going to bring this out so you can get it. If you study this out correctly, 1909 was the last statement she made. Now, from 1909, from 1798 to a particular year, now the French Revolution actually came into being in 1789. 200 years later would give you what? 200 years later? 1989. Do you remember anything that happened in 1989? Wait a minute. Now I want to show you something. I want to show you as we come down to this point. I want you to get this. Watch carefully now. I'm not guessing anything. I'm not making nothing up. I want you to just watch and look at the facts. First of all, you and I are in a countdown, and we don't even know it. For 191 years, from 1798 to 1989 to 1981, the prophecy of Daniel 11 stood still. You understand that? 191 years, this prophecy stood still. And in 1909, Ellen White would write, which is another, what, 80 years later, 80 years later, Ellen White would begin to be writing, 80 years, 1909 to 1989 is 80 years, and she would begin to write in 1909 that the prophecy of Daniel 11 is almost met fulfillment. So this prophecy stood still all that time until 1989, three powers were on the scene. You remember what they were? There was the United States and the papacy. Ronald Reagan and John Paul II met in 1982. Is that right? Okay. And then, remember, they met and they were conspiring how to bring down the who? The Soviet Union. The Soviet Union is the atheistic power. At that time, they had a meeting called Gorbachev Meets the Pope. That was right on CBS News. Before we had these cables and everything we got now. And that happened, and what we didn't realize when we saw that event, that the Advent movement from the time of the end had begun to start. That the jump starting of Daniel 11, when now the king of the north shall come against the king of the south again with chariots and horsemen, many ships, would now take place with the help of the United States of America. We didn't realize that this was a direct parallel to the time of the end of Daniel 11:40, the first part that we talked about just now. Brothers and sisters, you and I are in a countdown. Watch now, tomorrow morning, we're going to look at that second part. And tomorrow morning, we're going to look at the next power in the Advent movement that would come on the scene, and how that power has also been brought back on the scene to show you that you and I were not to count our history as dead facts, just to rehearse what only happened with Ellen White and them, but also understand that the history of our movement and the events and characteristics that would take place, when those characteristics will come again, it will let you know what time it was. Though you see murder, crime, violence, war, God says, stop. Hold this. Look at the timeline. Look at your historical timeline from the time of the end to 1844. If you understood that, then you would understand that your time right now is Adventist. You don't have no time to be playing church any longer. If you understood this, you wouldn't have any time to have any problems with each other or attitudes with each other or people splitting over this or that. You would understand that you got a heaven to win now and a hell to shine, and you need to make sure you're right with God and stay right. and that you need to have the daily presence of the Holy Spirit in your life. If you understood what time it is, this is not time as usual. Time is going, and you are coming up before God. If you understood what time it was, you would change many things overnight. You would be on your knees fasting and praying because you don't want your name taken out of the book of life if you knew what time it was. And that's, and the purpose here is to show you historically that we are there and we're getting there fast. Now, if you don't believe it, who were the powers in 1798? Atheism. Who was the power in 1798? France. Who was the power in 1798? The papacy. Is that true or not? Or am I, listen, I got intelligent minds here. I'm not a preacher that believes that everything I say is 100% dominant and nobody else can think for themselves. I got men in this audience that think for themselves. And I ask you one thing with your independent minds to think. Was there such a thing as the papacy and atheism in 1798? Was there the Protestant Reformation around that same period? And before that, who was the power that weakened the papacy before, so that she could not fight against Napoleon? You remember what power that was? That weakened the papacy for almost 500 years? It was the Ottoman Empire. It was Muslims. You better think about what I'm telling you, because this is historical. I'm not giving you something that I'm guessing on. We can prove every point. Now watch this. If that be the case, and the papacy now in 1798 and 1989, the papacy shows up, but the papacy doesn't have our own army. What does Daniel 8:24 tell you? Somebody read Daniel 8:24. Come on, look at Daniel 8:24. I want you to see that. I got to close you with this point, but I want you to think it through. Come on, Daniel 8:24. The Bible said he would, his power shall be what? Mighty, but not of his what? Own. So what does the papacy do? She chooses the strongest power to be allied with. Who was the strongest power when she came to power? France. Clovis, King of the Franks, 508. 508 to 1798 is your 1290. 508 to 1843 is your 1335. I'm talking about your historical history. And 538 to 1798 is a time of the papal persecution period and the time of the indignation when it shall be for an appointed time. The papacy used the French, and the same power that brought her to power took her out. Now, it was the Protestant Reformation that wakened the papacy spiritually. With Martin Luther in what year? What year? I want you to say that. What year? 1517. The Bolshevik Revolution took place when? How many years is that from 1517? From 1517 to 1917 was 400 years. And who created the Communist Party? Karl Marx is a puppet. Who's the real power? Jacobinism. Who controlled Jacobinism? Jesuits. And who was behind the Jesuits? Illuminati. Are you with me now? The papers of power. You want to go down there? Ignatius and his fellows. Okay? But now let's stop for a moment. Why am I bringing this up? Because if you trace the history correctly, guess what? Our history is, first of all, being repeated with the same characters coming back on the scene right now. It's going around in circles. It was the Muslims that weakened the papacy from the military and economic standpoint. It was the Protestant Reformation that weakened the papacy spiritually. That by the time the Napoleonic Wars takes place, the papacy has no military power to fight or resist Napoleon. And she doesn't really have the spiritual power because Luther has weakened her. But when the papacy begins to begin to come back, and also with her deterrent to Protestantism, which was communism, The first thing communism do is they go into Eastern Germany. Why did they go into Eastern Germany? And why did they go into the Russian Orthodox churches of the East? Why did they do that? They were not by the need of Rome, but they were also the very heart of the Protestant Reformation. Don't you get it? And Luther was, in 1517, he did that. So 400 years later, as the communists came to power, who did they attack? Where did they start off? In Russia. There was mostly Eastern Orthodox. Isn't that right? And what did they do? They got rid of the Tsar. They destroyed religion. They took the people and put them in camps and then slaughtered them like flies. And then created an atheistic country that was once Protestant. And killed off two generations. By the time it would end, the next generations would have no clue of their previous history or heritage concerning Protestantism. That's what you see. Eastern Germany? Why Eastern Germany? Eastern Germany was the heart of the Reformation under Luther. The 95 Theses were nailed at the door at Wittenberg in Eastern Germany. So why you been thinking all this is just World War I, World War II? Each of these wars were designed to destroy Protestantism. In Europe, in the old world, and now we've finally set the stage for World War III to destroy Protestantism in the New World. With the New World Order and the Middle East conflict. Tomorrow morning, we're going to talk about state of winds. You don't want to miss tomorrow morning. But tonight, I'm going to close with this statement to have prayer with you. The agencies of evil are combining and consolidating. They are strengthening for the last great crisis. Great changes are soon to take place in our world, and the final movements will be rapid ones. The enemy has succeeded in perverting justice. Casey Anthony case. And a couple other cases have come up to notice and taken world attention. And filling men's hearts with the desire for selfish gain. Justice standeth afar off, for truth is fallen in streets and equity cannot enter. The cries of a starving humanity are coming up before God. And while every species of oppression and extortion, men are piling up colossal fortunes. Is that what's happening today? Listen, it says those who hold the reign of governments. You worried about the debt ceiling? Listen to this. Those who hold the reins of government are not able to solve the problems of moral corruption, poverty, or pauperism, and increasing crime. They are struggling in vain to place business operations on a more secure basis. In Welfare Ministry, page 266, Ellen White says, money will soon depreciate in value very suddenly when the reality of eternal scenes opens to the senses of man. Listen to this one. The land boom has cursed this country. This is what she's writing to Australia at the time. Extravagant prices have been paid for lands bought on credit. Then the lands must be cleared and more money hired. A house to be built calls for more money. And then interest with open mouth swallows up all the profits. Debts accumulate. And then comes the closing and failure of banks. And then the foreclosure of mortgages. Now, why am I saying this? Because the same teachings took place in the French Revolution. The Jesuits alone flourished in the French Revolution. Manufacturing jobs and everything was closed down. But let me close you with this one. In India, China, Russia, the cities of America, thousands of men and women are dying of starvation. The moneyed men, because they have the power, control the market. They purchase at low rates all they can obtain. Sound familiar? You want to get out your house? Well, we at the bank company figured we got a way to get you out, but you got to accept the short sale. The money men, because they have the power, control the market. They purchase at low rates all they can obtain and then sell greatly at increased prices. This means starvation to the poorer classes and will result in civil war. By the way, she is not talking about the Civil War of 1865. She's talking about a civil war coming in our country as a result of a financial crisis and starvation. There will be a time of trouble. Notice what she said. This means starvation for the poorer classes and will result in civil war, period. There will be a time of trouble such as never was since there was a nation. And this is taken from General Manuscript, type August 13th, 1899. Manuscript releases, volume 5, page 305. Volume 5, page 305. Brothers and sisters, you're on the verge of a major crisis. If you don't believe it, truckers are threatening about talking about going on strike as we speak. Police, 16 states have already said that they will not accept disarmament of guns in this country, and they will not accept Obamacare. You better start. We, as Adventists, as a people, we better start praying. Because what you've been watching in the Middle East for all this time is coming here. And your peaceful moments, your happy days at the mall and the playgrounds and everything else is about to come to an end. You better get ready. And you better be in a praying, godly, holy living that God's angels may be around you to protect you and your family where you travel and where you go. Because just as they had the Boston situation, remember what Assad said when America was threatening to bomb Syria 2 weeks, 3 weeks ago? Assad said if America bombed Syria, then expect anything. Meaning this, that the war will not be confined to Syria. It will be confined to every city in Europe and America and the nations that will be involved in the war, and suicide bombing, mall bombings like you saw in Pakistan and in Kenya can take place in America. Then you will understand Luke 21, men's hearts failing them for fear and for looking after those things coming upon the earth. We better get ready. How many want to be ready? Let us pray. Father in heaven, we ask that you would help us. Your word is fulfilling. We see the times in which we live in are solemn and important. Great changes are taking place, and the final movements are and have been rapid. Lord, but your eye is upon your people. Your love is still stretched out for your people in this church. That while they have light, privilege, and opportunity, they might enter in while the door is still open for them. While the Spirit of God can still plead with us and while he can still convict us of sin, righteousness, and judgment. Lord, let us heed this pleading of the Holy Spirit. Let us not grieve thy Spirit that he be withdrawn from us. Now, Lord, please save us and help us be ready. Keep us in thy care and help us keep our eyes on Jesus as we talk with one another, as we live together as husband and wives, as families. Help us, Lord, to fear thee and to humble our hearts before thee and submit to having your character and crucifying self and sin. We might represent you and be